Good afternoon, student friends. Let us start with the chapter on classification of soils. It is a very important chapter for understanding the soil behavior. Now, let us get into the first understand what we are going to study in the classification of soils. What is the purpose of soil classification, basis for soil classification? Then what are the different classification system, namely based on the particle size classification, that is the MIT classification and IS classification and textile classification. Then we will move on to the unified soil classification, which is called as the international soil classification, and it is universally accepted and adopted throughout the world, and any derivation is based on that. And we have got the IS classification, which is a derivative of the unified soil classification. Now, the important thing in that is the plasticity chart, which is used for classifying the fine grained soils. We will be discussing about its importance. Then lastly, we go to the field identification of soils. Now, before getting into the subject, it is worthwhile to discuss, to understand who are all the contributors to the growth of soil mechanics, a brief idea about what all they did, their educational background and their contributions, which would help us to have a better understanding of the subject. Now, in the beginning of 20th century, when the things were in the offing, the industrial revolution led to the requirement of construction of multi-story buildings, more construction activities took place. Then there was a need for economizing the construction activity, especially the foundation. Now, people were using the rule of thumb, the scientific bent of mind coming into the limelight, then they had to have a rational background before deciding what should be the better way of designing the foundations. Now, the important contributors to note with was Carl von Terzaghi. He is rightly known as the father of soil mechanics. Along with him, there are many contributors. Important contributors were Donald W. Taylor, Ralph B. Peck, Arthur Kesegande, Alec Wesley Skempton, and Loretus Berum. Now, in the today's thing, I will just discuss about the three contributors, that is Terzaghi, Peck, and Kesegande. The remaining three we will discuss in the next class. Now, to start with Carl von Terzaghi, he was born in Prague in Central Europe. He was born on October 2, 1883, and he lasted for a very long time. His contributions are worthwhile. He expired on his last on October 25, 1963. Died in Massachusetts, United States of America. This date is very striking to me, because exactly 1 year after this death, exactly October 25, 1964 is my date of birth. Therefore, I fondly remember this date. He is rightly known as the father of soil mechanics. He had his basic education in Graz in Australia. He received his degree in mechanical engineering. In those days, there was no specialization in civil engineering. He graduated in mechanical engineering in 1904, and even though he was having favoritism towards geology, he had a lot of fascination for geology. That was the most important thing which made him to get into soil mechanics. He was also interested in philosophy and astronomy. After his graduation, he had to compulsorily work for 1 year in the military service. Then when he was fulfilling his military obligations, he had an opportunity, had sufficient time to go through a popular book which was written in English, the field manual of geology. He translated into his native language, German. Then after this, he returned to the technical university in Graz, in his place Austria, for 1 year after this, and combined the study of geology, whatever he had got knowledge, he tried to combine, and he started offering courses. And later he also had other courses offered by him on highway engineering and railway engineering. His early professional years, his first job was as a junior design engineer for the firm Adol Baron Pitley in Vienna. He became involved in the geological problems the firm faced. They were involved in the construction of hydroelectric projects. The hydroelectric dam was under construction. Therefore, there were many geological problems. He had to focus on the construction of those structures and also the geological problems associated with it. Then, along with that, he had one more challenging project which he had to address in, at St. Petersburg. Both of these were a great success to him. Then, during the 6 months, then later he moved on to Russia. There he spent 6 months and he developed some graphical method for the design of industrial tanks. See, he graduated in mechanical engineering. His fascination was geology, and he did his PhD, higher studies, okay, whatever contributions were there in his practical life in the initial stages. That he converted into a thesis and submitted for his PhD at the university in Russia. It is very fascinating, a mechanical engineer, fascination in geology, did his PhD in structures. He was a very good mathematician. In 1912, he moved to United States. He took a tour for 1 year. He saw all the major dams construction sites, because that was the time where a lot of activities on the construction of, especially the major dams, Masonry dams were under construction. Slowly, the earthen dams, as the knowledge of soil mechanics came into picture, then they later started handling earthen dams. But he, during his tour, he studied major dams, their construction and the first hand knowledge. Then he had to come back to his country when the World War broke out, and he had to work in the army as an officer. Then for after a short stint, he also worked as a, in the airfield. Then he became a professor at the Royal Ottoman College of Engineering in Istanbul. Now it is called the Istanbul Technical University. Later, see, because of his mathematics skills and because of his engineering skills, he collected all the data. He put in the form of all his research findings on the settlement. Especially when he moved to America, he saw many buildings settling. He saw, and people were not knowing why buildings are settling. And he came out with his research findings in the form of a book, which is called Earth Bow Mechanic, Both on Physical Structure, Ground Ledge, which was written in Latin. Later, he converted all that knowledge and he coined the word soil mechanics. It was then who we got the term soil mechanics in 1925. That was his contribution. Then his first task in America, United States of America, was to bring his work to the attention of engineers. All his knowledge was transferred to the engineers. He wanted to emphasize the importance of field knowledge and how to handle soil. This he proceeded to do by writing a series of articles for the Engineers News Record. That was a small journal which was started in the early in part of 20th century. He started writing series of articles. Then he started educating people through his articles. He found the facilities at MIT and he set up a laboratory there to go into the research of soil mechanics. He entered into a new phase of publication. After his research at MIT, he started again writing many articles which he was handling from the large scale projects. In 1938, see, he was actually from Austria in Central Europe. He permanently migrated to America. He took up a post at Harvard University. Before the end of the war, the Second World War, he consulted at the Chicago subway system. That was a challenging project with soft clay. This thing, there was no one to show them light. They, along with him, was one more associate which will come later, Ralph Wippack. It was a real challenge to work in soft clay to understand the strength of the. Then the Newport News shipway construction and the raising the Normand and other among others. These are the important projects, notable projects. He became an American citizen in 1943. And he remained till his death in 1963. In Harvard University, he remained for 10 years from 43 to 53, and at the age of 70, he had to compulsorily retire because it was a mandatory age, and later its health also restricted him to restrict his work. The American Society of Civil Engineers, because of his great contribution, in 1960, they established the Carl Terzaghi Award. Still, when he was present, because of his contribution, This was given to any author of outstanding contribution to knowledge in the fields of soil mechanics or subsurface and earthwork engineering and subsurface and earth construction. It is a very prestigious Karl Terzaghi award. There will be a Karl Terzaghi lecture and that contribution will be published as an article in AAC, American Society of Civil Engineers, that is the presently Geotechnical and Geoenvironmental Engineering Journal, that is called the Terzaghi lecture. The Terzaghi and Peck library, which is managed by the Norwegian NGI in Oslo, in Norway, it holds the extensive collection of his papers. All the papers are placed there. The Mission Dam in British Columbia, Canada was renamed in his honor as the Terzaghi Dam in 1965. That is his legacy. He has left out. See, even after his death, people remember him through his name. In 1936, Terzaghi served as the chairman of the first International Conference of Soil Mechanics and Foundation Engineering, which was held in Harvard University. It was a great landmark. It was, the credit also goes to his student Kesakande. I will discuss about that. On that occasion, the International Society of Soil Mechanics and Foundation Engineering was founded and Terzaghi was elected as its first president, and he continued to be in that position for a very long time till 1957. His important contributions to soil mechanics, one is the one-dimensional consolidation theory. He was a wonderful mathematician. He gave that theory as well as the solution, and he also fabricated the one-dimensional consolidation apparatus. That is very interesting. He used his cigarette box to develop the consolidation apparatus. Initially, he did with that, and later he transferred that into a proper apparatus. Then effective stress principle, even today with some modifications, we still use that effective stress principle, which will be discussed later by other colleagues. Then bearing capacity theory, even today for any consultancy work, still we refer to that bearing capacity theory proposed by Terzaghi. Then tunnel classification support system. There are many other things, it's really, he was a beacon of light. Except Antarctica, I think he has traveled all the continents. He has any problem throughout the world till his death, everyone used to consult him. That was his greatness. The important publications, all his work have been documented in the theoretical soil mechanics and about his contributions, and the important work, the first publication, Soil Mechanics and Engineering Practice, was published along with his co-author Ralph B. Peck. It was published in, first published in 1948. It was the most influential textbook in the geotechnical engineering. And even now, if you read the book, one need, student friends, please note down, this is the, we should always read from the Bible. Bible for geotechnical engineering is Soil Mechanics and Engineering Practice. You have to learn from the mouth of a guru. Therefore, you need to look into this book. At least from the library, you can just refer it, see the important things which are really very fascinating. That has been edited. Now we got the third edition of this book with an additional co-author. Messri also has contributed. This is, this came out in 1996, third edition. What was the influence of Terzaghi's work on the soil mechanics profession? Not only did Terzaghi start soil mechanics, but also he exerted a profound influence on it until his death. I told you, he was a beacon of light. 2 days before he died, he was diligently working on a professional paper. That was the immense involvement in the work, till his death he has worked. Terzaghi's writings contain significant contributions on many topics, especially consolidation theory, as I told you, foundation design, that is the bearing capacity, and construction, that is the tunneling and other things, and coffer dams analysis and landslide mechanism. Probably Terzaghi's most important contributions to the profession was his approach to engineering problems, which he taught and demonstrated. Not only was a good teacher, he was also demonstrating it in the field. How we can? He was the person who coined the word standard penetration test for the test we do it in the field. We will discuss about that when at the appropriate stage. Now, you can see a building here that has settled, means as a significance, he was a person who worked a lot about the settlement of buildings and thing. With his death, on October 25th, 1963, the engineering profession lost one of its most eminent and colorful personalities, the founder of Swan Mechanics. Had it been, there was a Nobel Prize instituted for engineering, he richly deserves it. Unfortunately, for engineering, there is no Nobel Prize. A single person in his lifetime, that is beyond anyone's imagination, that was his contribution. Along with him was his associate, Terzaghi's associate, Ralph B. Peck. He was born on October 23, 1913, I think 30 years after Terzaghi was born. He died recently, February 18, 2008, in New Mexico, where he had settled after his retirement. He did his little bit about his engineering background, his education background. He got his civil engineering degree in 1934, doctor of civil engineering. He got his doctorate in 1937, both degrees from the Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute in New York. Professional career, 1937 to 1938, he started his career as a structural detailer for American Bridge Company. After 1 year stint there, he moved on to the laboratory of Arthur Casagrande at Harvard University. He became a laboratory assistant. There, while working with Arthur Casagrande, he could come out with his degree. Then, between 1939 to 1942, he meets Terzaghi also, and he asks him to get him a faculty position there. He says, no, you first work in the field. Believe me, you work, see, under the guidance of Terzaghi, where Terzaghi was the consultant of the Chicago subway project. He gets into that project as assistant subway engineer, and he gets a lot of experience. That was a real challenging project. In 1942, after that experience, he joins the University of Illinois. There, he continued as a professor till his death, till his retirement from 1948 to 1974, nearly four decades of his teaching career and research career. What are his professional achievements? An acclaimed international expert in the field of solid mechanics, Ralph B. Peck has helped to change the face of the earth through his discoveries of the way solid behaves. Through his work of the Chicago subway in the early 1940s, he emerged as one of the undisputed leaders in the development of and practice of solid mechanics and foundation engineering. Yes, developed because of this field experience. There is a contribution in the bracings. Whenever you make an excavation for having a foundation, then it becomes I'll explain to you. Whenever I need to make an excavation to a certain depth, I can have an excavation if it is a clay soil without any support. If you go beyond that, we need to provide a support called the bracing. Now, we try to provide the support. This is also a retaining structure to retain soil, but it has got a slightly different behavior compared to the actual retaining walls. Now, to develop this thing, he developed what is the pressure that is coming. See, if you want to design this retaining structure, it is a bracing. He developed what is the earth pressure. He gave the earth pressure diagrams. Professional achievements. As a distinguished professor at the School of Engineering of the University of Illinois, he conducted field and laboratory research on the stabilization of railroad beds and embankments. He worked on northern dams and stability of retaining walls, that is what I told you, and settlement of foundations. He has worked on many other projects in pipeline projects and rapid transport system in Chicago, San Francisco and other places. He was with all his great achievements, President of America, Ford gave him an award, National Medal of Science, in 1974. Many times he used to return back, even after his retirement, he used to come back to Illinois to interact with his students and his fellow colleagues. He used to give at least twice a year a lecture, series of lectures, and he had a close association with his students and faculty members. Now, let us come to Arthur Casagrande, who was born in 1902 on August 28. He was born in Australia. He was also from the place near to where Terzaghi was born. He comes to America and he settles there, and he contributes a lot. And there are many disciples who have contributed for the growth of soil mechanics. And he was the first PhD student of Carl Terzaghi. And there are many other achievements to very all first things to him. We'll discuss about that. He died in 1981 in the United States of America. Professional career, not much is known about his educational background. He got his degree maybe in Austria, this Central Europe. Then he comes to America, he settles there and he starts his career. First work is he worked as at the Bureau for Public Roads and as a research assistant under Terzaghi at MIT. While at MIT, he worked on the soil classification. Important thing, he has given the unified soil classification when he was working during the Second World War time, when the why I'm trying to cover all these things, because we need to know who are the contributors. Because when you want to discuss about soil classification, you should know who, what was the contribution done by Casagrande and others. The important thing is that during the Second World War, there were many airports which had to be air pads, where helipads or air pads, temporary things there, where you need to have a runway to have the landing of these aircrafts, army aircrafts. Then they had to know what is the good soil for having that base. Then they had to classify the soils, which soils are good for this thing. Therefore, under his leadership, he came out with a classification which is now called as the Unified Soil Classification System, which is called also the International Soil Classification System. He gave the plasticity chart, which has got and one line is there in that plasticity chart, which I will discuss later in the subsequent classes. It is based on his name. Then he also worked on the shear strength testing and the frost action in soils. Later, he has worked on lot of on dams, the piping failures and other things, the seepage of this thing, and we will come to that, construction of flow nets and other things. He was the right hand of Terzaghi for several years and made or contributed to making the fundamental developments of soil mechanics. He later became a professor of soil mechanics at the Harvard University. Many of his students were inspired by Casagrande and entered the field of soil mechanics. These men have later become the creators of the geotechnical engineering field as we know it today. As a researcher, he was a wonderful researcher. He worked on many fundamental problems such as classification, seepage through dams and shear strength. It is safe to assume that the A line which is there in the plasticity chart is after his name, Arthur Casagrande, Arthur. Therefore, we call it as A line. Time being, you don't know what it is. Okay, we'll come to that discussion very clearly, and then I'll remind you. Most geotechnical engineers haven't seen of as many dams he has worked. He has worked on so many dams. Forget about, we will never have an opportunity to, or we'll never go and visit so many number of dams. He has worked on the design of those dams and the problems associated with it. To honor his lasting contributions to this area of geotechnical engineering, his former students have created Embankment Dam Engineering, the Arthur Casagrande volume, which has been published by Wiley in the year 1974. Now, with this background about the contributors, only a part of them, we will get into the, before getting into the classification, we should know about the index properties. Even before that, some fundamentals about the soil mechanics, I will just spend few minutes about. Now, we need to know the basic difference between, because we use soil as a mass, what is the difference between weight and mass? Because when we come to the units, it is very essential. What do we mean by mass? Mass is the amount of matter present in a material, and weight is the force that is exerted on that, the action of gravity. See, if I take 1 kg of cotton or 1 kg of any soil, on earth it may weigh something. If you take it to moon, because of the action of gravity being less, it may weigh different. If you take it to other planet, again it may weigh different. Therefore, the mass is same, the quantity of material is same, whereas the force exerted on that material is going to be different. Therefore, this weight, which is represented as W and M, mass as M, the relationship between weight and thing. So, if you take the Newton's second law, we know that the force acting on any mass is mass into the acceleration. Here, the acceleration is the acceleration due to gravity. Therefore, the mass into acceleration due to gravity gives your weight. With this, now we should know what is the unit of weight. the unit of weight is in SI units is expressed as Newton. Now, how Newton is defined? 1 Newton, which is denoted as N, is defined as, if you go back to this equation again, weight is equal to mass into acceleration due to gravity, or mass into acceleration. This is the force, this is nothing but I can take it as F is equal to M into A. This is the force that is acting. Okay. Therefore, the Newton is nothing but the amount of force required to accelerate a mass of 1 kg of mass it has to be accelerated the acceleration of 1 meter per second square. This is that quantity of force that is required is called the Newton. Now, the index properties, before coming to the index properties, soil is a particulate medium. My colleague Professor Prasad might have covered all these things just as a precursor for my next thing. We need to know what are the index properties. Index properties of soils. Now, I will list them. See, this is the index finger. This is a pointer. We index. Okay, the way we call it as index finger because this points to anyone or anything. Similarly, these properties are the properties which indicate, which are used for indicating the behavior and also for the classification. Why do we use it? We use it for the classification of soils for various engineering applications. They are listed as water content, you can see here, water content, specific gravity, then particle size distribution, Atterberg limits and in situ density and relative density. We are concerned about the particle size distribution and the Atterberg limits. These index properties which are used for the subsequent discussion will be used here. Now, when you want to do the particle size distribution, we take sieves, we clean them properly. You can see here any particles which are sticking are removed properly. You can use a wire brush and you can remove those particles sticking onto finer size sieve size. Then we take this set of sieves and arrange them as shown in the next thing. We can see here they have been stacked here with a decreasing size, and we place it on a mechanical sieve shaker and try to shake it for a specified known time. It is usually 10 minutes. There is some base inclination, it keeps rotating and it sieves. As we do sieving of a flour which is got from the flour mill, which any housewife will be doing or mothers will be doing it, and we also have done it. Okay, this is similar sieve analysis. We are going to sieve the different size particles into their different sieve sizes. Now, after doing the sieve analysis, we try to weigh them properly. Okay, the individual masses are taken here. After the sieve analysis, we try to see. You can see here as the sieves are graded, you can see here the higher size particles are written and higher and bigger size sieve size, and you got sands which are finer, then the gravel will be placed below. Like this, the fines will be still finer, then definitely be coming below. Now, the finer, still finer portion which cannot be found out from the sieve analysis can be done by conducting a hydrometer sedimentation analysis, either by using a hydrometer or by using a pipette analysis. So, these are the things which will be covered in detail by my colleague Professor Prasad. Now, this is only a brief discussion about the how we are going to do the hydrometer analysis. We are going to prepare the sample in a proper in a particular way. We are going to use the dispersing agent solution, and we are going to disperse the particles, and we are going to place it in a stirrer for dispersing it, and we are going to transfer all that material into a 1000 ml jar, and you are going to shake it properly. You are going to use a hydrometer. You can see here this hydrometer, this is placed in, and you are going to allow it to settle, and as the settlement takes place, the density is going to change, and you are going to measure the density of the settling medium at the center of the bulb at regular intervals time, and using that data we can get the grain size distribution. Now, Liquid limit is another parameter, because when you got fine grain soils, I already told you, Arthur Casagrande has given the plasticity chart for classifying the fine grain soils. Therefore, this is one of the important parameter. This is the liquid limit apparatus, which was developed by Arthur Casagrande. This is called the percussion cup device. This is the percussion cup device, which is this was developed in 1930s, and you standardized it to get the required values for the engineering applications. Now, we will go to the way how it is determined. So, you can see here the it is defined as the shear strength, measured shear strength of the soil at a particular shear strength. What is the water content? We try to remove a groove, the number of the base will have certain resistance. When it drops, this cup is dropped, we will get the water content at that measured shear strength. Now, to get this, we are going to take a soil sieved through 425 micron as per our Indian standard. We are going to sieve the sample and collect the sample and mix it with water. After mixing it with water, we are going to place on the, so you can see here, you are going to check here for the base side, so that when it drops, this cup drops on the base, it is going to induce a shear stress there. Then we are going to see the soil resistance by the, you can see the soil paste being placed here. We are going to remove a groove in this. See, you can see the groove being removed. I'll show you one more thing where a clear groove can be seen, which is removed. Now, this when it is dropped, okay, it is going to close. See, it has closed along a distance of, you can see this distance. This distance is of an inch or 12 to 13 mm. You can see here another view. See, this is the groove taken. This is the closed portion. See, the groove has closed. Now, we remove the sample for water content determination. So, you can see here the water, the sample being removed, placed in a container for water content determination. Now, there is a particular way how this experiment is done with a particular rate. I think my colleague is going to explain to you. Now, the water content is obtained for the different number of blows, is plotted as water content was number of blows on the x axis. This is the x axis in is a logarithm scale, so that it becomes a straight line. Now, at 25 number of blows, okay, we are going to interpolate. See, wherever we get 25 number of blows, okay, which strikes the flow curve, we are going to take that water content, that is known as the water liquid limit. The water content at which a soil changes from plastic consistency to semi solid consistency is called the plastic limit. Now, to get this, what we do, we need to take a soil paste, which is used for liquid limit, then we further dry it and we try to roll it into a thread. When you can get 3 mm size thread, we check for whether the soil is having any cracks, visible cracks, shear cracks or shear cracks. If those cracks are not there, we again roll into a ball, again make into a thread, and when it comes to 3 mm, again we check for the cracks. Okay. When we can see the soil starts cracking on the surface, then the soil has ceased to become be a plastic material. Therefore, it is the end of the limit to be a plastic material. That water content, then we take those threads and put into a water content cup and find out the water content. Now, what is plasticity index? The range in which the soil behaves as a plastic material is called the plastic index. Sometimes they call it as PI, or some people use it as IP, is the liquid limit minus the plastic limit. That range in which the soil behaves as a plastic material is called the plasticity index. Now, you got the plastic limit water content and liquid limit water content. This is the range. What is the definition of a non-plastic material? In case some material don't have, even though it is fine, you will not have any plasticity behavior exhibited in the soil, especially if you have got more of fine sand and if you have got coarse silt. The for such kind of soils are called. Now, let us come to the exact classification of soils. Now, with this background, we will see why soil classification is required. What is meant by soil classification? It is actually the arrangement of soils into different groups, so that the soils in a particular group will have a similar behavior. Say, in a class, we will have varieties of students. We group the students who are good at music, who are good at academics who are good at giving good at sports. Like this, in the similar way, soils are non-homogeneous because we have got varieties of soils. Now, a similar group of soils, maybe clay soils with high compressibility, this is used for certain engineering applications because we know their behavior. Similarly, sand, okay, it has got some behavior, you got gravel or clay gravel. You see, like this, we are going to group these soils into a particular group so that we can know their behavior and their engineering applications. Now, we have got a lot of varieties of soils covering the earth material, therefore, it is desirable to systematically arrange them and classify soils so that we can get the groups which can be having similar behavior. In a more broad way, in a general way, we can say cohesionless soils and you got cohesive soils. Usually, coarse grained soils are called cohesionless soils, and you can this fineness increases, then usually they are called cohesive soils. Now, this is in a very crude way. Therefore, to have a better understanding, we need to compile them into soil classification system. Now, let us see. The purpose is natural soil deposits are never homogeneous in nature, wide variations in properties and behavior are commonly observed. It is quite possible to have different varieties of soils, and also their behavior and the composition is going to be vary. Even in a particular area, point to point, you are going to have the variations, and also with depth and also with the lateral extent. Therefore, we need to have the average properties of these soils and try to group them into a class. It can be done through classification system. One can obtain an appropriate but fairly accurate idea of the average properties of the soil group or soil type, which is of great convenience in any routine type of soil engineering project. Now, from engineering point of view, classification may be made based on the suitability of the soil for the use as a foundation material or as a construction material. For complete knowledge of the soil behavior, all engineering, see, this is only going to give a qualitative behavior, qualitative value about the or the idea about the behavior of soils. If you want the complete behavior, you need to know, if you want to quantify, you need to go for the engineering properties, namely the shear strength, consolidation characteristics, and you want permeability characteristics, and you got the compaction characteristics. A classification system thus provides only a common language between the engineers dealing with the soils. It is useful in exchange of information and experience between the geotechnical engineers. Wherever you are, you can communicate. You got simple properties like indices, grain size distribution, liquid element, plasticity index, and we try to classify. How do you classify? It is all done based on your accumulated experience, and you get an estimate of the properties. Then you can achieve the engineering purposes. Now, this is fine. This is our requirement. Okay, this is the end use. But for this, we need to have a particular base. Okay. I always like to go by the shortest route, a convenient route like this. In the classification, the system should be, you should have limited number of groups. If you got too complicated thing, it becomes very difficult to use. Therefore, we should have limited number of groups, and it should be based on the engineering properties which are most relevant for the purpose which the classification is meant. It should be very important, simple, and it should be, you should use terms which are easily understood. Okay, you should not make it very complicated. Now, the various classification systems are particle size classification, textile classification, highway research board classification. This is especially the name itself indicates, it is used for highways, and unified classification, which was given by Kasagande, and you got the derivation Indian soil classification system. Now, the name itself suggests particle size, based on the particle size, individual particle size, either it is gravel, sand, silt size or clay size. Now, while using this system, we need to be very careful in the classification system. We do not say silt and clay, because we use along with that silt size and clay size, because based on the classification thing, we get the particles of that size. We do not know whether it is really clay or it is a silt. If it is a clay, it has to exhibit plasticity. If you take a rock and you try to powder it and make into a floor of that size, clay size, it will not bear as a plastic material. Therefore, it is not, it is exhibiting non-plastic behavior. Therefore, it is not clay, it is of clay size. Now, particle size, classification of the particle size is immense value for coarse grain soils. For fine grain soils, it becomes difficult, more emphasis should be given on the plasticity characteristics. Now, based on this, we have got the US Bureau of Soil Classification, US Bureau of Soil and Public Road PRA system, then you go International Soil Classification System, and you got the MIT system, and that is Massachusetts Institute of Technology system, and Indian Standard Classification. Now, based on the PRS is term. Now you can see here the clay size, any size less than 0.005 mm is called clay size, and between 0.005 to 0.05 mm is silt size. And in the sand again we got four groupings: very fine, fine, medium and coarse. Now the various sizes have been given there. Okay, between 1 mm and 0.05 is the sand as per this classification. Then you got fine gravel between 1 to 2 mm, and anything, any particle greater than 2 mm is gravel. Now international soil classification, this is was given by researchers at the soil congress which was held at Washington in 1927. This was earlier known as the Swedish classification system, later was adopted as the international system. The additional term when you think in this is compared to the previous one, if you go back to the previous one, we do not have the term called muzzler. Okay, the mo or muzzler has been used for the salt particles in the size range between sand and silt. This is one additional, between the silt and sand we have got one additional term called the muzzler. That is the difference. Otherwise you got this classification: gravel is almost greater than 2 mm is called gravel, and less than 2 mm to 1.1. Okay, the slight changes in the particle sizes. Now MIT classification system, this was developed by Gilboy. Gilboy was an associate with Terzaghi when he was at MIT, and he was a wonderful contributor for soil mechanics. He gave the system. This is again based on the divide into four groups: gravel, sand, silt size and clay size. Now it has been given here, we got clay size or clay colloids having size less than 0.002 mm, very fine size, and we got silt size into three groupings: fine, medium and coarse, and sand into fine, medium and coarse with the respective size from 0.06 mm to 2 mm, again gravel greater than 2 mm. Now IS classification system, which is a combination of the grain size and also the plasticity chart, which is also similar to the unified chart classification. Here you got based on the classification on the based on the particle size, the classification comes here. Less than 2 micron or 0.02 mm is the clay size, and the silt size is from 75 micron to 2 micron, and anything greater than 75 micron up to 4.75 mm is sand. Again it has been regrouped into 75 micron to 425 micron is fine sand, and between 425 micron to 2 mm is medium sand, and the coarse portion is 2 mm to 4.75. Now gravel again is divided into 2, 4.75 to 20 mm is fine sand, fine gravel, and 20 to 80 mm is the coarse gravel. Then 80 to 300 is cobble, and greater than 300 mm is boulders. Now the textures and classification, the visual appearance of the, what we are discussing is about the particle size. Now coming to the textural classification, the texture, the visual appearance of the soil is called the texture, and based on that people try to not only the particle size and also how it appears, how the particles appear. Now clay mineralogy and how it affects water holding capacity are not evaluated with this classification system. We are not going to use the clay mineralogy here. This is based on the particle size plus the how it appears. Here this is also called the triangular classification system. A equilateral triangle is taken and it is divided into various zones, that is 10 zones, and we can see this. This is the chart. We got on each side, we got the clay, we got the silt and the sand. Now this was adapted from US Public Roads Administration. It is very simple thing. See, you got this percentages of the sand, percentage of silt from this direction. Now what we are going to do, see, for example, I got a soil containing 15% clay, 70% silt and 15% sand. Now how to locate this 15% clay? This 15% clay, see here, okay, it is here, then it is 15% clay here, then you got 70% silt, 70% silt, okay, then you got 15% sand somewhere here. If I start moving, so we will go to the next slide. See here, this is 15% clay, then 70% silt, and you got 15% sand. Okay, it comes to this zone. Now what is that zone? This zone is the silty loam. This is how they are going to find out the type of soil as per this classification system. Now let us take another example. If a soil contains 30% sand, 20% silt and 50% clay, the point P, okay, I have shown here. Now you can see here 20% silt is here. As you move along this triangle, okay, you come here, then you got 70% clay, then you got 30% of sand from here. If I move here, it comes to this point P. Therefore, it is a clay soil. This is how we are going to classify based on this system. This is useful for classifying soils considering different constraints. If you got a combination of these things, then it is become very easy. Now, however, you need to make a correction. If the particle size, see, if you go back to the previous thing, you can see here the particle sizes are based on. See, you got these sizes given. Okay, the sand is between this size and sand. The biggest size is the sand. Is it anything greater than 2 mm is not allowed here. In case the soil actually contains more than, what is to be done? A correction is to be applied. You need to make a correction accordingly. You have to make it to 100%. Then it is useful in classifying different constraints. Okay, now before concluding today's lecture, it's very essential that we saw before getting into the classification system, we saw what all the contributors, what were the important contributions. We discussed about the three contributors for the growth of soil mechanics. Then we saw what are the index properties. We saw what is basic index properties required for the classification, the water content, namely the Atterberg limits, the plasticity properties of the soil, that is the liquid limit, plastic limit and shrinkage limit. In that we are going to use liquid limit and plastic limit and the difference which is called the plasticity index. Then we got the grain size distribution. Now, based on the this background, we got into the classification system. So, classification soils, what is the purpose and what are the requirements of the classification system? It should be a very simple system, simple number of less number of groups, and the notations which are used should be very simple. It should be easy to understand. Without that all background, people started trying to classify the soils for easy understanding, so that it becomes a common language between various engineers. Now, initially people try to go based on the particle size, that is called the particle size distribution and particle size classification system. And later, when you got the combination of various size particles, how to group them. Therefore, they try to take the texture, that is the appearance of the soil, based on that they try to group into various zones. Okay, if you look into that, it is a very interesting system here. You can see here you got the sand, again the variation from sand to loamy sand, then sandy loam. Sandy loam means sand is less, loam is more. Sandy clay loam, because it is transiting, there is a transition towards clay. You got some amount of sand, clay is also there, loam is there. Actually it is a loam. Loam is nothing but a combination of sand, clay and silt in a certain proportion. Okay, then it is called a loam. But if it is more of sand, it is called loamy sand. Less of sand and more of silt and clay, then it is called sandy loam. Like this is a transition and you get complete clay, only pure clay. Then you got a little bit of silt and clay, more is clay. Therefore, you use silty as an adjective, silty clay. Then you got silty clay loam, because you got the again combination. See, you got, you may have some percentage of sand also. Then if you have more percentage, this is silt, therefore more percentage of silt is coming here, then you get more of silt, silty loam, silt loam, then completely silt, little bit of sand and no amount of clay or little amount of clay, therefore you got only silt. So, this is going to be useful for, this was the initial stages. Now, when we come to generalized classification, you got the unified soil classification, based on which even the British system of BS code is also used and Indian standard is also used with slight modifications depending upon the requirement of the particular country. They are all very useful. We will try to discuss about the various contributors, the remaining contributors, namely you got Taylor, D.W. Taylor, then you got Skempton and Barham. The next class, because they are not directly related to this, therefore I didn't start in this class. Next class we'll discuss about the contributions, then get into the other classification. In the next class I'll be discussing about the unified soil classification, and later in the other two classes I'll be discussing about the the Indian soil classification. We'll work out numerical examples. We'll see what are the things asked in the examination. Then finally, in the fourth lecture I'll be covering about the field identification. This is all in the laboratory. In the field, what is to be done? Okay, you got any questions? Please feel free to ask me. Okay, I'll conclude this lecture. We'll meet in the next week. We'll meet on 4th September. Thank you.